My name is Brian Main. If you haven't seen my talks earlier this morning, I am an artist and animator at Cause of Creations here in Vienna, and I'm speaking with Matthew Ward, who's in California right now. So Matt's a very busy guy right now, and so versus all the other speakers having a 45-minute presentation, we're going to have a fireside chat here in the evening in Vienna. Morning your time, so I guess we'll have a fireside breakfast. And we're just going to have a general chat about the work that we've done, how we know each other, what it's like to be a creative in our respective fields, and just have a nice fireside chat as the conference wraps up today. So yes, I'm talking with Matthew Ward. Maybe you can introduce yourself, Matt.
Hi, I'm Matthew Ward. This is a nice digestif for the conference, right? Easing out of it and enjoying ourselves here. I'm starting my day, y'all are finishing it. I run the cinematics teams at Bungie on the IP Destiny here. And actually, Brian, I'm in Seattle, Washington.
Seattle, sorry.
Spend most of my time in California, but now I'm up here where Bungie's located. Our headquarters are up here. And been working on the Destiny franchise for the past 8 years now, since the first release. So it's been a lot of fun. I have a killer team. We're a small part of a huge studio and a huge initiative to make an amazing video game. And we just released our latest chapter, DLC called Beyond Light, just over a week ago. So this is really cool to be talking to you today and catching up with everyone there in Vienna.
So now you oversee a team as cinematic director. How big is your team over there?
Our team fluctuates, but for the most part, usually we're sitting around anywhere from 12 to 20 people. And that includes cinematic content and NPC content. So that's non-player character content. You got to run through the game. You see some people talking and they're doing stories and they're acting out in front of you. So we try to do immersive storytelling channels, and I have an amazing team that I get to work with every single day of very talented animators and layout artists and producers and designers and general art artists, world designers and whatnot. That the cool thing about the cinematics team is that we're kind of this hub that gets to touch everything in the game. We're not playable, but we have to exist within the world that's being built by the game and the experience that the players are actually going through. So we get to work with every other department pretty much in the entire studio to make sure that our cinematics narratively connect and visually connect and, you know, holistically connect the game. So
and you it's have not, to pull that all together.
Myself, I have a lot of help from my team. My management style is very collaborative, and I think actually Bungie is very collaborative. We have to be. We're going to, again, world creation. World architecture and creating a world as big as Destiny requires a lot of people helping out, and a lot of cooks in the kitchen, and that means a lot of balance and a lot of communication. So, but yeah, it's a lot of managing a lot of small tasks for the bigger task.
Now, I was going to ask you this later, but since we're already talking about it, it makes sense. You've had to do this during coronavirus right now, so you just had a big release. And you're working with all your people remotely for the past 8 months, I gather.
We have. Since March, Bungie's been a work-from-home studio. And we've even been mocapping from home, which is amazing.
You mentioned you went in someone's garage the other day and did some mocap?
Yes, one of our animators, a very talented animator, has one of the Exynos Movin suits. Basically we just set up a camera. We use anywhere from Microsoft Teams to other tools that would just help us communicate better visually. And we sit here and I direct him through the screenplays that we're shooting for the cinematic content. And then he directs himself for the stuff we're doing for the NPC content. And, you know, we get a ton of mocap. We send it to our layout artists and they cut it up and make it work. It's pretty amazing. And It's been a bit laborious, but because we know the technology, we know the pipeline as well as we do, and we know the ease of it when we have it all working and we have a lot of automation for us when we're at the studio at Bungie, we've kind of just boiled that down to almost like an independent filmmaking style, which is really killer because I think too often in the big budget race of visual effects films, or in this case, video games, it's really easy to get lost in the tech and not understand it, not need to understand it, because your job's very much here and you're focused on this. But luckily for me and Bungie, we have a lot of people that just love everything they do about it. So they get down to the roots of it, and they know how to pull it apart and then boil it down to something we can do at home. So it's been surprisingly not as difficult technically. I mean, this is everything has its challenges working from home. This can be mentally hard. This can be physically hard on people, you know, people that are used to getting out and running. And we also are in Seattle, so we're about to go through our winter, and the sun kind of disappears for a little while here too.
But about it the other day. I think you guys are here in Vienna, we're officially in a full hard lockdown. And I think you guys are probably just 2 or 3 weeks behind us, if not a week.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised. So,
yeah, but as far as that goes, I wouldn't change your current workflow. You've already been working at home. Here's a question: like, what if your normal pre-corona productive rate was 100%? Where are you guys right now?
Well, that's a great question. I think, you know, I think we're anywhere in between 80 and 100. And the reason I'd say those numbers is that sometimes we're going to 110 still, you know, but we have a studio culture that doesn't like to crunch. Yeah. We don't believe in that. The video game industry's once or twice had some bad experiences with that. So we try to avoid that as much as possible. So we're able to get a lot done. I mean, look, Beyond Light was pretty much created from home almost. We've gotten a lot of pre-development into it, but the big main chunk of it was done working from home. And it's a monumental task. We did some seasonal content before it, and we're still running. And the thing is, we're learning real time, just like you guys are, I'm sure. Everyone's figuring out how to do it better. So we post-mortem as we move, we look at things, we make decisions, and then we look back at them and we say, how can we do that better, you know? We never look at anything as like a regretful decision. We're just like, okay, we can learn from that. So in that case, that's why I think that curve fluctuates. But we do change. We have to change our scope just like anybody else. We have to change how much we can push out and how easy it is to push stuff out. And we are developing new techniques to fill in the gap.
So you guys being able to do 100%, 80 to 100% doesn't mean that you've lowered your standards too much, but...
No, I mean, like, I think we've actually kept our standards where they are. We believe that we don't want the product. I think with anyone, the expectations from our community to be, you know, they're highly valued, and we value that as well. So we're doing the best we can to hit the expectations.
Are you afraid that you're never going to go back to a physical workplace again, and that the company is just going to say, "Hey, we saved a lot of money having everybody work at home"?
No, I'm not afraid of that at all. In fact, I think that's something the company, we're really good about, is reminding each other that, hey, we're going to get through this, and we're going to be together again, because we do know we're stronger together. And in the meantime, we're going to make it as blurred lines as possible that we're working from home. And so, you know, again, we believe in the collaborative effort. We believe in person as much as possible. And I think that's any artist initiative and creative endeavor that's built of a studio our size. We get a lot more done when we're together, and it's a lot more fun when we're together, right? I mean, no one likes to be isolated like this for too long. Yeah.
Well, do you have any tips? Like, as a team, do you guys have like virtual parties or things like water cooler events where you meet during the day and exchange?
Yeah, that's exactly what we do. I mean, I think the biggest tip we have is reminding each other that we're alive and human, and, you know, taking that time to invest in like an hour a week at minimum. We have a hump day celebration every Wednesday where we get our teams together, certain teams, at least my teams all get together, and we try not to talk about work. Try to talk about what we've been doing at home, what movies we've been watching, what games we've been playing, what art we found online, or animation clips or short films, or what's on Netflix, something that inspires us and allows us to disconnect. Because that's the hard thing. When you're at home and it's just like the evil of the refrigerator around the corner, we're packing on the COVID 19 pounds, you know, versus the freshman 15. We're looking at sitting in front of a computer, and we're here, and it's hard to say, oh, you know what, I got to get in my car to commute home, to be in home by time for dinner, to put the kids down, et cetera, et cetera. So you can always just sneak back in your office and catch yourself getting sucked back into your work. So
yeah, do you have any tricks, like any tips that way, like separating, like you're at home all day long. How do you separate, okay, I'm at home doing family stuff or I'm working? Do you have like a ritual or something?
I have a wife that'll like come in here and like pretty much cut the power if she needs to. So, but no, like for me, I at 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, depending on what I've got done, I take a look at what I've got done for the day. I take a look at what I've got done for tomorrow, and I make a decision to that mark if I'm done for the day or not. And if I'm not, I'll go and close up some stuff with some people that are online if they haven't called their day as well. But it's an initiative. And as a lead of the team, if I'm just sitting there working all the time and people see that I'm available all the time, they're going to have this slight, tinge of having to work as well. And so as a leader, it's even more important for us to actually step back and say, okay, everybody take some time off. Everybody kill your day at 5, 6 o'clock, whatever that is for you. And everyone show up on time too. So it's like a ritual. You got to build those rituals even at home that disconnect you. And so for me, that's just it's self motivation. I don't think there's any tips I could give you other than if you find yourself having a problem or if a coworker tells you you're having a problem with it, you probably have a problem. And then just figure out things. I mean, they sell timers on Amazon that are safe search protector timers that'll just shut off your monitors at a certain time. And that could be what you need sometimes. That's a very good idea.
Yeah. I might have to look into that. Christmas is coming. So I have my own way of doing it. I've been freelancing for 20 years before starting the company.
Yeah.
And for most of those years, I'd say for about at least 15 of them, I worked externally. So I just coughed up the money, had an external studio. So I had that physical act of waking up, going to an office. But this was after I had a good 5 or 6 years where I worked at home. And you had mentioned rituals. That's what I did. I had a thing where I woke up every day, put on clothes, got out of my pajamas, and then I would go. Vienna's filled with all these beautiful cafes, so I would go to the cafe, drink a coffee, read the paper, if only for a half an hour, but just so that when I was done having that morning ritual, I would arrive home to my studio, but it was like I had done commute to work. And then I did it at the end of the day to signify, okay, now I'm done with my office hours at home. So whatever you have to kind of do to trick your brain, you have to do it. You have to find out what it is. And everybody's kind of stumbling through this right now, so everybody's figuring it out.
Yeah, if we weren't so locked down, I think working from home would be a little easier if you could go down to the local coffee shop or a little diner and do some work from a desk. But even those places are closed down for us.
Yeah.
Actually, the fun thing is I've actually turned my garage into like a second living room, and that's been kind of like my little fun little thing. Got some golf green. Laid that out, put our lawn chairs inside there, got a little fake fireplace heater that lights up with LED lights. So you kind of get creative and you think of, okay, how can I create that little cafe environment in my garage?
Tiki bar, something like that.
Tiki bar would be great.
Yeah.
Oh my God. Yeah. Anything to do with sand and surf and sandals, I'm all about it.
So as we go along, we have an active Discord channel, and anybody who's watching and has already stepped on the Discord can feel free to submit some questions as we continue to speak. And then later on in the talk, we'll move over and have go through some question and answers from the Discord. But I want to backtrack now, because here at the Pixel Conference, it's 2 days, and usually the first day, the Friday, is oriented towards students and people learning or people trying to enter into the field. And the second day is usually more professional focused and more technically focused. So you and I had already talked about this, that we didn't want to have you do a classic presentation where you're just showing your working process. We wanted to talk about creativity in general. For those who don't already know, Matt and I have known each other for 25 years, if you can believe
it. That's pretty crazy. About 25 years.
We were 18 when we met. So Matt and I used to be roommates at Savannah College of Art and Design.
Yeah.
So we lived in, talk about quarantine. We lived in a one room, it was basically an old dormitory that was made out of a hotel, out of a Hilton, I believe, right?
No, it was a Holiday Inn, yeah. That
Okay.
was on Oglethorpe, and they called it O House, and it's still standing and still rocking out today,
You've been
yeah.
back to Savannah a couple times, so did you walk through and did they
No,
check you at the
like the
door?
first
And
time, I think the first time we went back, I went into the lobby, but they're pretty locked down now. I think everything changed after 9/11, so for us and any college and just the States, so a little harder to just kind of walk in and try to get a free bowl of cereal from
okay.
us.
Well, it was quite the
But yeah.
experience because here we were 18-year-olds. Basically, everybody who most people who go to Savannah College of Art and Design in Georgia are not from that town. I think you
Yeah.
hung out with some townies, but there was a lot of international students, and I came from Detroit. Matt came from Chesapeake, right?
Virginia. Yeah. Chesapeake, Virginia.
And so everything is just, everybody is just thrust into this new environment. And you and I were living for an entire year in basically a hotel room.
That's exactly right.
Let's start out with this. Maybe you can tell everybody, like, what got you, where did you start? When did you start being creative? What made you decide that you wanted to follow a creative job, a creative career?
Well, I remember talking to you about this a long time ago. We had somewhat similar things, but I'm not going to vouch for you. I went to a high school that had a heavy hand in arts, so I was big into music. I was in marching band and all that. That would pay off at SCAD in a way. And then art classes and stuff at the college were pretty big. I mean, at the high school were great. And I had a motivation to get out of town and meet other people and do something grander. And I was always a big fan of in the 90s, the early animated films like The Little Mermaid, Aladdin, Lion King, the classics that we grew up with, and decided I wanted to be an animator. And so I started studying back then the way to do that because we hadn't really figured out CG animation. In fact, 95, when Toy Story came out, kind of changed everything. That was the year I graduated high school. And that was kind of like brand new, right? So illustration was the way to go. So I studied illustration, got into SCAD. My roommate, Brian Main, who is a phenomenal illustrator, just another example of all these amazing, inspirational people I was now surrounded by. So it was just awesome being saturated in that. But I slowly realized at SCAD that my love for animation was more film-based, and I just happened to like to draw a lot, and I was okay. I was pretty good at drawing. I thought I was good at drawing until I saw Brian's work. But as I always joke, the first film class I took at SCAD kind of opened my eyes to say, wow, I'm actually a visual storyteller. I like film. I like the presence and the study of film, and I like the story that's told in that. And I like how that can transcend in all these different areas and gaming and television and film and even just little short films and little in commercial content even. So I thought there was a really kind of a really cool world and how SCAD helped me open my eyes to getting into film. And I slowly diverted from illustration to film. And then film was so expensive, I got into animation because I slowly realized that, wow, computer animation, which was brand new at the time, and SCAD was kind of the forefront of it. They had Maya as a beta, which was impressive because later that would lead me to go work somewhere that was using tools that were much more archaic than Maya. And they were blown away that a student was working amongst these professionals and knew more modern software than they did. That company, by the way, was ILM. But I think that was really interesting is that SCAD paved that way. And then I kept leaning on myself more than you could at the time because the computer animation was kind of unknown. The pipelines were unknown. Teaching it was unknown. But film was very much known. It's still, again, they've been doing it for so long. If the film pipelines weren't much different, so we could teach film. But if you couldn't afford to shoot on film, you could then take those principles into the computer labs and apply filmmaking techniques into computers. And that's what got me into the thing that I learned about called pre-visualization, and that kind of was my rocket ship from there.
Now, I remember the first time you told me that you wanted to get into animatics and pre-visualization, and I believe it was 95, the year we lived together, was when the special editions came out. And
right.
I remember you teed up a special feature on one of the videos. Back then in the ancient times, movies were played at home on videos. And you showed me a portion of the making of Return of the Jedi, where they showed how they pre-visualized the speeder chase scene in the forest, and they had done it with basically toys. So
yeah, they'd taken the toys and just remocked them up. Yeah.
Yeah. So they had a table with like a mock-up of trees and things like that, and then they had some sticks where the toys were connected to, and they just did some very raw footage of how each scene would be played out and what the timings would be. You pointed that out to me. You said, "Okay, that's what I'm gonna do."
Yeah,
I had never heard anything like this before. It was a brand new thing, and you were the first person to show this to me. It's very interesting your journey, because there's like probably one of the first versions of animatics. Star Wars was, you know, led in a lot of innovation that way. The first Star Wars movie was basically, the animatics were cuts of old World War II footage. Then they moved on from that to toys, I guess. And then
they used storyboards. They used anything they could to convey and plan a message. I mean, failing fast is what Previs was all about back then. And it wasn't even called Previs. I think they were called Videomatics. They had probably a different term depending on who was doing them. But what I loved about that was that, yeah, it was the whole concept was to shoot a film fast, prove it, plan it, and then decide whether or not it was worth investing in or how cool it could be. Because it turns out back then, Dennis Muren would run miniature shoots and be able to sell the whole speeder chase to George Lucas. Like, hey, I think we can do this. I think we can go into the woods. I think we can shoot this. And here I did a shot breakdown. I even got these toys, and I got this little cheap film, 8mm camera, shot it all, cut it together. And it took me like a week to do. And that's only just evolved into using more and more tools and techniques. I mean, you see Previs today, and it's just like almost like a final film, depending on who's doing it.
I'm going to get to that. We'll talk about Attack of the Clones, for example, which I think was a milestone as far as that goes. And that's a movie that you worked on. Let me go through the timeline a little bit longer. So
yeah,
a little bit more. So you got an internship. The first one was ILM or Lucasfilm.
It was internship at Industrial Light and Magic. Yeah.
That was your junior year, right?
Junior year, between junior and senior year. Yeah. That summer. And I got it in the art department, cause I thought that was the only place I had a shot to really get my foot in the door. Cause, my illustration was strong enough. My concept art and stuff like that, that I'd been doing and studying was good, but editorial, animation, all that, I didn't have the chops yet, but so I applied for the art internship and got in. Yeah, I got it as a bet with another roommate of mine.
Okay.
He and I just bet each other that we couldn't get our application in on time.
Huh?
And yeah, which is another, a little bit of motivation.
Another, one of the Michiganders, right?
Another Michigander, yeah.
Yeah. So you had a pretty, and here's an aside too, you had mentioned that when you submitted, you had to submit a drawing portfolio, basically. This was an interesting thing that I found, because you had also mentioned, I remember I learned Form Z at SCAD. I couldn't afford one of those jazz discs, so I could only make stuff that could fit on a zip disc.
Right.
Again, the ancient times. That technology was moving so fast at the time. At the time, the software was changing when it came to CG and 3D graphics. I had taken a different track from you at the same school. I went to illustration, so I wanted to graduate from SCAD with an illustration degree. I have a Bachelor of Fine Arts in illustration. And it was funny because this junior, senior year, the classes started getting contaminated with 3D guys. And the reason why is they said that they want to see you can draw. Like, the software is moving so fast. You kind of had a lucky break. You got Maya at the early stages.
Right.
But other people were kind of left stranded because the stuff was just spooling through so fast that in order for them to get a footing in these places, they had to show that they could draw. So all of a sudden, I was in these classes that were like twice as big, and they were all filled with 3D guys that were kind of like clamoring to get a drawing portfolio together because they had spent the past 3 years just doing CG work. So I thought it was an interesting thing during that time that it all comes down to drawing at the end of the day.
Again, it's all technique, composition, all that stuff. I mean, like, I think still some of my camera guys, some of the most talented guys that frame our shots are composition experts before anything else. I mean, you can give them any kind of camera and they can find something beautiful through the lens. And I think that's a study of foundational art. So, yeah.
The way I like to think of it is it's like if you learn Latin, it's not difficult to learn French, Spanish. It's a vernacular or a language that you can apply really to anything. I would actually feel perfectly confident if someone asked me to design a chair or something like that. The principles are the same. You just need a critical eye. You need to know how to test. You need to let yourself kind of experiment and fail and work stuff out. So it's really just satisfying the curiosity, but doing it in a targeted way.
I mean, it's a cliche thing that Pixar would always say is about they could easily hire a 2D animator to be a 3D animator because all it is teaching them the tools to do the same job in a different way. So, but fundamentally, it's all about the motion, the composition, the arcs, and how a character moves and expresses. So, ILM, it was really great. It was eye-opening. ILM to appreciate the art side more than the tech, and I think they still do today, to be honest. And I think most visual effects companies do is that the art drives the tech versus the other way around. So,
yeah. Now we could queue up our special video, I think, now. Speaking about art, one of the fun side effects of doing an internship at ILM was that while we were in college, Matt, being the big nerd that he is, had a full Darth Vader costume.
That's right. We made a Darth Vader. We had the Darth Vader mask, and then we had an idea to shoot. This was for
interest. I hope
this
you
was
cleaned like, it out in the meantime.
Oh, God, you were so sick that day. Brian played Darth Vader for us, so we made a costume in our dorm. And we used paper plates, black plastic paper plates that we would cut the armor part, the shiny parts, and we just totally had everything. This was really detailed. Darth Vader's suit lit up, the lights all lit up and everything, and we fitted it to Brian, and we went out near the airport, which now there's like hotels all over the place. It was just nothing but just plain as the eye can see, fields of grass. And we shot a little short film with a buddy of ours, Lily Trimmer, and Brian fighting, doing a lightsaber battle with the toy lightsabers. And we did not try to do effects. We just literally had you guys out there fighting with lightsabers, which is hilarious. And
with toys.
And then we put music to it and sound effects and whatnot, and you just got lost in it. You didn't. And that was for an intro to film class. That was like my final assignment for intro to film. And I think the assignment was go out and shoot a medium, close up, and a wide. We made a whole short film.
We did a fan film back when fan films weren't.
Yeah, no, and it was. And technically, we were making a fan film. Yeah, before the internet. I mean, truthfully, we didn't even have a video on the internet. There's no place.
Back then, I mean, we're dating ourselves here.
That was about it, and maybe some Netscape, you know, if you had time. If you had time, took a while to download it.
GeoCity websites, things like that. But you can see here we're playing this, and the fun part is that Matt, when he went for his internship at ILM, the special thing was is they were able to rotoscope the lightsabers into the fan film that he had made. So this
I was so embarrassed showing that. Yeah, I showed it to some people working in the art department. They were actually doing the lightsabers for the marketing material, and I was learning how to put lightsabers on using Photoshop onto the actors for episode two. And they were saying, oh, this is the same technique we use in After Effects. And I showed my short, and one of them said, hey, this is a great opportunity for you to learn how to roto. And how about we do the real lightsabers at ILM on your fan film over those toy lightsabers? And it was awesome because it was a training, just full on learning how to do lightsabers at ILM. I mean, come on, it's whatever birth, right? So I was like, this is amazing. And the second thing is it added this legitimacy, I thought, to the film. And I recut it a little bit. And then, yeah, that's right about when, that was like 98, when the internet was starting to allow for some video content so you could go in certain places. And there was a fan film called Troops that came out back then, but the
it was Cops for Star Wars.
Exactly.
And Cops as a TV show, but it was a reality television show. One of the first ones at the time, actually.
And then there was Death of a Jedi. And the funny thing is that director, Kevin Rubio, and myself got interviewed several times together. And we were like the only two fan films for a long time. His was much more better than mine. We got interviewed a lot more because then slowly that articulation of all this, the more and more fan films kept pouring out into the internet. And then YouTube shows up one day, and the next thing you know, it's just so easy to add your fan films up. So yeah, now it's like a whole genre.
Yeah.
Films.
Yeah, I mean, there's productions out there of people making stuff. It's crazy.
It's amazing.
The reason why I brought that up is because one of the things I want to talk about in our fireside chat is side projects. I'll get to it at some point because I want to keep going through your journey here. You came out of art school basically, and you went to go. Right out of art school, you went to go work for Lucasfilm, right?
Yep.
And right now, I mean, you've been working 8 years in the game industry, but you really cut your teeth in the film industry. On so many films, I couldn't count. Some of the big ones being the prequels, The Matrix, Babe, my personal favorite, one of the best films of all time, Catwoman.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, Pitoff. Yeah, the European director out there. Yeah, it was such a great film.
I remember you told me we met in California a while ago. You mentioned that you did the scene where Catwoman is, you had to figure out from the live action her jumping out of a window and her being intercut with a CG model and then her landing on the ground again. And that was at the time your task for that.
Yeah, movie. I was at ESC Entertainment with Warner's for a long time, and we that was our film after The Matrix, and we had to do it. That was really cool to learn a lot of stunt blends from stunt photography into full CG and then back into a different plate but with Halle Berry. Say what you will about the end product, I think a lot of people that worked on the film, we got to do a lot of things that were kind of innovative. And there's a lot of that film where she's fully CG, and we had some amazing animators. And the mocap technology back then was just getting started into the feature
film. It's frustrating to see a film that didn't come together so well or wasn't well received. It's maybe not going to be thought of as a classic, but was well done technically. And you worked on a lot of those films. Whether they've been good or bad films, they've always been done well. Technically,
it was the first time I learned reading a screenplay. I loved the screenplay, and then seeing the final result and it being vastly different the way it was executed. So yeah, you learned something.
Must have been some committee decisions in there that got in the way. So.
Probably some suits involved. Yeah.
So you were at Lucasfilm, and you stepped right into it. You worked on episode one during one of those internships. In fact, I think I remember I got you a little bit drunk and you gave me a little bit of spoilers. And at the time I remember being like, really? Jar Jar Binks? Okay. I thought you were joking with me, but it turns out, yeah. So you worked on the prequels if we talk about animatics, the Attack of the Clones was like, that was a big jump. That was amazing. Like the graphics that were coming out of what you guys were doing basically looked like a final film.
The episode one animatics were a massive leap from what we'd seen in the past to I mean, the whole pod race and the way that was planned, and the art department with David Zoritz and Kevin Bailey and Ryan Tuttle, they did some incredible stuff that hadn't been seen since the bar. But our job was to rewrite the bar and to re-raise the bar and to just do it even bigger. So, you know, something like George likes to do is, again, these are technological driven directors, is that he wants to keep pushing it. So that means we have to push the technology in order for the art to be pushed. So we, our animatics had to be very detailed to help inform what George wanted to do, so that when ILM came to make the final product, a lot of the detail was present. So it was a, it was a tough gig too, like late nights and a lot of weekends, just to keep in pace with what we had to do.
Was it like sand? Was it coarse?
Was it? Guys, gets everywhere.
Gets everywhere.
Yeah.
It's not like other things that are soft. So
you know too well.
Okay. So from there, your big dump was working with Zemeckis at what was then, again, at each stage of this, you're really on the cusp of kind of a trend that's happening. So if we talk about animatics, it had a start, but you got it really at the apex of its evolution, at a big
we kind of kicked it off, yeah.
The next thing that you went through was motion capture, when you worked with Robert Zemeckis on his films.
Yeah.
You want to talk about that a little bit?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, again, another technologically driven storyteller director was Robert Zemeckis, still is today. And I think he had this kind of mantra going around saying, like, he always wanted to, he recently said that R&D is not really a part of filmmaking. It's not something that exists or is planned. It's kind of like we get a screenplay, we see the potential in it, it's assigned to a director, and the director has a vision. And then that vision is what is announced and constantly advertised, and then in order to pull out that vision, tools and techniques have to be built. And I joined Bob when we were working on The Polar Express was the first film, and he'd gotten the book, and I think the story goes that he loved the style and the look of it, and he wanted to kind of bring that to life on screen. So he wanted to animate a film, not a live action film, one that was straight out of the pages of the book. And the best way to do that at the time, Sony was pitching, we could do this thing called performance capture, where we could capture everything, not just motion capture the body, but the face. We'll get the voice. We can actually have Tom Hanks play multiple characters together and multiple ages and all these things. And for a director, that was a pretty amazing thing to be offered. And for an actor, that's pretty appealing too, I'd imagine. So. We got to see that evolution. Now motion capture had been around for a long time. We'd seen full featured motion capture films before, like
I think Final Tron Fantasy. Had it even.
I'm not sure, but we definitely had it in the Final Fantasy film that came out prior, and then, you know, like video game companies have been using motion capture for a long time. But this was a full feature, full on, 100% mocap, and it kind of kicked off Bob into this world of performance capture films, where he could take actors and enhance their performances and further control the final composition. If an actor didn't hit a mark, we could actually correct that. Things like that, it would allow for a little bit more perfection on what a filmmaker would want to get. Because I mean, Bob would always talk about he'd go and shoot live action, he'd come home on the dailies, he'd see something and, oh man, the focus puller didn't nail it, and so it's a soft shot now. And or it was raining so hard that we didn't see all this rain on the lens, or it was raining so soft we didn't even see the rain pick up in the 24 frames per second of the emulsion. So like things like that, he could go in and dial and really create what he had in his head. And now,
this wasn't the Zemeckis, but I remember you telling me a story on the prequel on episode one. There was a scene in the Jedi round table where Lucas was instructing Jake Lloyd, the guy who played Anakin Skywalker, to make a certain expression with his face, kind of like a cursed look. And you had told me that at the time the kid just couldn't nail it. He was like
Oh no, no, it was in episode two, and we had a bunch of children on set that
Okay.
were it's when they come out and the Master Yoda comes out there, and all the kids are they have the little short lightsabers, the younglings or whatever.
Yeah.
And I think we'd had to, in previews, we'd had to correct some eye lines because the kids would deliver their line and then they would look off to their acting coach to
Oh.
see if they got it right. Now they'd be kind of like, did I do it right? And it was a kind of a common thing. It was told to us it was a common thing. So we would go in and we'd correct their eye lines, or we'd have to freeze their head while the rest of their body had some motion, just to convey what ILM would have to go and correct. And how much of that made it in the final film, I'm not sure. But yeah, it came down to even that kind of that. Again, George would love a take, but there would be something off about it, and we could correct it. We could get ILM to correct it.
Yeah, I remember you describing whole scenes. There was like meditation scenes where Yoda was speaking with spirit forces and things like that. There's all this raw material that no one gets is privy to because it's all pre-visualized, made, and then thrown on the cutting room floor at some point.
Fix it in post is a very common thing, but it's not even fix it in post. It's more like enhance it in post and just or correct it in post and get that 10% that's missing. That happens all the time. You know, we have all kinds of processes and techniques now that allow for better final imaging for any shot in a film.
So this kind of work is really intensive. I mean, you're putting a lot of crunch hours in.
Film was heavy.
But as if that wasn't enough, I think probably to have find like a creative equilibrium, you've done a lot of side projects.
Oh yeah.
Everything from music videos, you're a drummer and a musician, and you have a lot to do with music, so you've shot a lot of music videos for artists. One of the things I liked at the time, another thing, you probably don't think about it much, but you worked on a movie review podcast before that was a thing. So
Yeah.
you produced that, so you always keep yourself busy with things outside of the thing that you're doing as your career. Would you like to speak to that?
Yeah, I mean, I think well, the music video thing was again another part of at SCAD. I did a music video for a Weird Al Yankovic video with my roommates at the time, other Michiganders. I had a thing about Michiganders. That was a ton of fun, and it got a little got me a little publicity in the film school there. I think it was the only freshman to win best music video ever at the college, and it was because it was funny. It was just kind of I think it just it was appealing, but I got hooked. And so when I got into feature film, it was one thing to work on feature films and be stuck in this digital world, but then I wanted to keep learning. Sometimes to keep learning, you've got to just challenge yourself, and you've got to, you know, go online, get master class, whatever it is modern today, and study something, read a book. But then I think artists are always itching, and we get bored easily, so we want to continuously bring our game, our A game, and we don't want to get complacent, so we always want to like try to do better things with it. So I've always started shooting music videos on the side. In fact, the big reason why I got back into music videos was that when we were on Star Wars Episode Two, I was surrounded by these incredibly talented artists that had never worked on a film set, like a real practical film set. So I said, "Hey, this would be fun. Let's go shoot a music video together." And we shot a music video at Skywalker Ranch in the scoring stage, just as a team, just doing it and having fun. And then that kicked off that music video, then led me to another music video, to another music video, and I started doing music videos on the side and some commercials and some short film stuff. And every time I would do that, I would learn something new that I could bring back to the day job, you know, and I could improve and enhance my communication, my collaboration, my empathy towards my team, and how I can better work with them, and I can find better ways to make them better artists too. So just last weekend I shot another music video, and I think that you constantly are challenging yourself and finding these little projects on the side, because I was very fortunate. Out of film school, I got thrown right at the top of the heap with George Lucas, and I was learning how to do things with a man that had kind of a blank check, and he was able to get a lot of anything he wanted. But when you're in the independent world, you're learning what $20 can do, and $20 in an independent film can do a lot. You know, like, can go really far if you have the right people and the right way of thinking, and the right experience. $20 on a film set for George Lucas will buy you a sandwich. That's about it, you know? So it's really cool to get down to the dirt, learn how to stretch the dollar, stretch the idea, creative limitations. You and I've talked about this in the past too. Like having those limitations almost help you make better decisions, you know? And at the end of the day, the edit of the film or the short or what have you is where it's completed and where it's polished and where all those decisions usually pay off, you know? But I love independent filmmaking. I love independent illustrations projects, you know, even doing a flyer for the kids' school or going to my daughter's class and decorating the door.
What's really nice about this is you're using this as a format to like mentor people as well. You had mentioned that you were working with a young filmmaker. He was helping you out on some projects. So you're really like giving people kind of a leg up in this industry and giving them some contact that they would otherwise wouldn't have.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, and the funny thing is that music video I shot last weekend was actually with a small group of SCAD students that are here in quarantine. You know, like they can't study at SCAD right now. So
SCAD's closed fully, right?
Like fully closed. Yeah. So they're all doing this from remote. So I said, hey, how about we get together and you guys could be my film crew? And we did the practicals and I just, you know, half of them knew already what they had to do. And then me, I was just going in there polishing what they had to do. Again, I used a lot of sailing terms. I'm a son of a sailor, and the idea that my job is to just nudge the wheel but give them the full grip of it. And it was a lot of fun doing that, because yeah, you have to pay it forward a bit, you know. And I think as we also, something you and I've talked about in the past, as we start to get older and wiser, we start to recognize talent underneath of us and we start to say, hey, how can I foster growth with that person and help them grow and take what I've learned and give it to them? And in doing so, we learn something new too. So yeah, I think that's just evolution of the art, you know, the mentor, mentee.
Yeah. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to ask the team here if there's any questions that have popped up on the Discord. And I have some questions of my own, but we'll take some other people's questions in the meantime.
Let's do it.
The Pixel Conference has a film festival, I believe, around 8 o'clock our time. So we'll try to be on time about this. Any questions? They're going to pop up on my screen here, Matt. So
you just fire away, man.
I guess I'll start while they're teeing it up. We talked about this the other day, but maybe you can expound on it. Okay, so you went from film. Now you're working in games. Maybe for a little bit you can talk about like what the difference between those two mediums is. And then the big question is, what do you see them evolving into further, especially now after coronavirus? I don't know if the film industry is gonna be doing as well as it did before, but games seem to be doing fine. How do you see all these things evolving in the future?
I mean, either way you look at it, film and games are both entertainment industries, and they bring something. They bring, whether it be 2 hours of an escape or, you know, 2 months, depending on what game you're playing. I think that we're building entertainment, we're building escapism and inspiration. So I think the delivery modules are different, but that's narrative based. I mean, there's an experience that you have with strict narrative and someone showing you images that move 24 frames per second and tell you a story. And then there's experiential content and how you can go wander through a world and find things and you kind of experience your own story. If it's not fed to you, you get to tell your friends about something you did and saw. There are different challenges and there are different delivery systems. I'm a big narrative guy. I'm a big story guy. So when I switched to games, it was because of several friends that I worked with in the film industry or had gone to SCAD, or I just knew other people. Said, hey, it'd be really cool to have you here because your experience could bring something into the game industry that we're doing, we're trying to do. And that's what led to me to come over to Bungie, because I thought, well, this would be a good opportunity for me to learn, again, challenging myself as well, about an industry I knew nothing about, but offer something in the world of cinematics or filmmaking that I knew a lot about. And again, although I'm in the film, the gaming industry, my team is dedicated to delivering narrative and performance that enhances what the game's functionality is and what the narrative of the game is and the experience of the game, because first and foremost, the game's experience is what takes place. So I always say the big differences between the two mediums is that film and games are both based on huge ideas and a final result. And the final result is always different than whatever the initial idea was. But in film, it's a subtractive thing. It's kind of like carving marble. You're just constantly cutting away at it. And then at the end of the day, you have your sculpture. And I think gaming is the opposite of that. It's an additive context of which like you're building with clay. So instead you start with something and you start adding more and more as you are able to add more and more. And eventually someone says on both mediums, all right, pencils down, we're done. It is what it is. It's now a work of art, and we have to put it out in the world and see how it reacts, and we have to learn from it.
So now, you were saying with games, this is different. Like a film, you have to, it goes in the can, it gets shipped out, it's done. But games are like iterative. They're constantly evolving, getting updates. So you're really like, you know, often in the film industry, like you make a film based on a book, and then you create a property out of it, and then you make sequels. Now, like basically that entire process of testing a property and then have it be successful is all being crunched together into games and with constant releases and updates.
I mean, the cool thing about games is that we're able to make them consistently, make them better, and consistently address feedback that we get from our audience, you know, especially when it's a live thing and our audience is in there playing it constantly, and we're able to go in and correct something that might be broken. Like, you know, a stormtrooper hitting its head. We can do that in games a lot easier because it's, you know, especially with a game like Destiny, we can correct something if we need to, or if we feel it's worth doing. But we're always still, just like in film, just like in games, we're trying not to go backwards. We're always trying to go forwards, and we're always trying to learn with what we did before. Same in the film industries. Yeah, you shoot a movie, it goes out there and it bombs. That means the next one, we're going to think about that. I'm sure that when Anne Hathaway was playing Catwoman for Christopher Nolan, they were thinking about the Halle Berry Catwoman, and they were kind of making sure that there was going to be enough of a difference to allow her to exist in that world versus the old one. So that's how films are corrected. And in games, there's a little bit more. It's a little easier to do.
You can tinker with it more, basically. Like you can hide your changes in ways that you can't with film. And that aren't nearly as awkward as making special editions or prequels or whatever.
Yeah, and there's a lot of semantics between the two. It'd be surprising. Like, something we would do in post in a film and how we would do it in games is very similar.
Well, now the technology is overlapping, too. You have real-time rendering, real-time stages.
It's amazing. Like, I shot on a movie. I worked on a movie with some of our layout guys from Bungie. Brought them along to Robert Zemeckis' film, Welcome to Morrowind. And when we were shooting the film, they had the Unreal Engine actually running real time. So, like, again, this world was kind of, the technology was colliding, you know, in the way from these game engines coming into the film sets and being able to show us real time work that was clear enough and concise enough in real time that the director could make calls on how the camera moved, how an actor moved, how it would look if we were real time projecting their faces onto puppets. It was pretty amazing. Or dolls for that matter. So again, now you look at what they can do with Unreal. It looks like a final rendered film image out of ILM. It's incredible.
Yeah.
So, and a lot of those people from ILM and from the technology sectors of the visual effects wings are helping drive that technology in games now too.
So we have a technological question.
Bring it.
Do you use machine learning for visual effects or animation?
Not that I know of.
Yeah.
I don't know. Not that I know.
That's for the tech guys generally.
Yeah, that's the deep tech. That I wouldn't know. You're asking the wrong guy for that. Yeah, to be honest.
Okay. Any more questions? That was a very technical specific question.
I would hate to make a guess because I would probably be wrong.
Okay. Okay, Bungie has these huge shared workspaces. I was working there. And are you missing it during Corona times?
Yeah, Bungie is. We have a killer building, and it's all over our website and our ViDocs. So that's one of the coolest things. When I left the film industry, which is very much cartoon, it depends on where you were. Like ILM was great, Industrial Light Image and Movies Digital was a beautiful facility. But when you're on a film set, generally you're on a card table or you're at a desk that's made of, you know, plywood and apple boxes. You know, you never know where you're going to be on location, and you just got to make it work.
Generally, what you see behind Matt right now, that's what a studio looks like. There's not, you're not allowed to have any light because you need a, you can't be, no light pollution in your room. So everything's
curtains. And it works even better up here in Seattle when we don't see the sun. So like we all have these beautiful tans, these blue skin tans. But no, we have an amazing facility at Bungie, and we miss it. Yeah, we miss it every day. The great thing about the Bungie facility that I can quickly say is that we don't have any walls. There's no cubicles. So it encourages collaboration, encourages communication. We don't have phones either at our desks. So you get up and you go talk to people. And we have a lot of little things like that enhance.
It seems like such an ancient thing to think about, people giving up and having working in the same space, talking with each other.
It's great. And we have an old movie theater with all the walls taken out. So imagine a multiplex with no walls, those massive theaters, right? And then just pods and pods of desks that all work together and they all flow. And it's amazing. But yeah, we do miss it. And it is something we're constantly looking forward to getting back to one day.
Someday.
So someday we'll be there.
Any more questions? That's it. Well then, let me see if I have any more. What's your next side project? You shot a video last week. Anything on the slate?
Yeah, I mean, right now it's that. We're just cutting that one down. I've got a couple other little things. Another thing is whenever I can work again with Robert Zemeckis on the side and do a little bit of freelance, I try to do that. I've got I've worked on almost every one of his films, even after working here at Bungie. But and a lot of my old friends are still working with him, which is great. But no, I don't know. You never know when the side project's going to come up. You know, I've been reading a lot, learning a lot. I've been watching Masterclass like crazy.
Okay.
Podcast. But also the States have been going through a lot of political interest, so it's been a lot of time. Kind of
really? No, I didn't know that.
Paper. Yeah, I know. Maybe didn't make its way out, but there's been a lot of that going on, and there's something really interesting about docuseries right now that have been fascinating me. And
okay, but like I'm an example.
What's that?
An example of a docuseries that you're speaking of.
Well, I mean, we just watched The Vow, which is nuts because that was happening in Vancouver while I was living in Vancouver for a little while, shooting some up in the film industry there, mm-hmm. And I have some friends that lived in Albany at the time too, so. The Vow is a docuseries about a modern day cult. And the funny thing is we finished that series the day that they when we finished the series, it's on HBO. I went on Wikipedia to look up this guy. It's just like, what the hell? This is insane. This guy's real. And it was the day of his sentencing. It was the day we finished the series. So I think little things like that, these short bursts of documentaries are inspiring and knowledgeable, and they're factual. They're a little bit more like less spun and a little bit more like presented.
One of the things I've gotten into, it's only three episodes deep. It's on HBO. Okay. It's called How To by Don Wilson.
Now, okay.
None of us are traveling right now, so we're all stuck at home. In the time that since Corona started, I had a trip planned, trip to Japan, going back to the States to visit family. Wow. I've been having staycation now for the past 9 months, but this guy has this kind of fun. Don't watch it with your kids. There's some shocking stuff in it, but it's a guy who basically he's kind of a flaneur. He walks around in New York City and he makes narration, but his footage, the weird stuff that you see in New York City, kind of stuff you see if you're able to physically travel there, the kind of fun New York City vibe. Is kind of intermixed with his narration and his storytelling, and it's as close as I can get to traveling right now. So it's kind of been a lifesaver because Birgit and I, my wife and I, watch it on weekends and are just kind of like, oh, this is like going to New York City. We get all the components of it without being able to do it.
I'll check that out, man. I haven't heard of that one. Yeah, no, we've been getting lost in all kinds of stuff. I'm watching The Undoing right now on HBO, and HBO's had a lot of great content lately that we've probably been saving their lives. And then I watched Queen's Gambit on HBO. It was Netflix.
Yeah, that's on the docket for me too. So
yeah, isn't that funny? Like in quarantine, we have these long lists of stuff to watch, and we can just talk about what we can. That's now the new sports talk for artists. It's not, yeah. We're not talking about our favorite player. We're like, hey, so what TV show are you watching? Oh, well, I'm watching. Yeah.
It gives you a sense of pride. You're like, I conquered that show. I went through 8 seasons of whatever show.
Brian, you haven't seen Queen's Gambit yet? Oh, seriously. Yeah. I can't hang out anymore. I'm afraid I'll ruin it for you. Yeah, it's that kind of stuff, yeah.
Let's do this. We have one more question teed up, if you have the time for us.
For it.
I know that usually take Fridays. You don't work on Fridays, but calling you in today, apparently. Here we go. Do you think the endless chase after more photorealism in computer graphics is at some point going to significantly decline or even stop?
I don't think it'll ever stop. But I don't think it'll ever outshine all the different styles of visual arts. I think there will always be a place for the super cartoony, the 2D, the hyper real. I mean, Destiny's not photoreal. We're an intentional hyper reality. I think there'll be a place where Bob Zemeckis, for instance, will find it, like he'll find that sweet spot, and wherever that might lie for him and for other directors, they'll find that style. I mean, it's just like a DP and how they light. They can either light like they're on a stage, or they can light like everything's natural. But it's always going to be about understanding when that's the most appropriate place to use that and how people are going to react to it. I think if you go watch a movie like Seven, you saw how Fincher lit that film. It was, it had to be gritty. It had to feel real. It had to be grounded, and it had to have that. It had to have like a dirty style to it for it to communicate the tone that underlie the story. I think if you go and you watch a family film that's a little bit overlit, and the colors are a little bright and more saturated, that's serving a purpose as well. So for me, photoreal chasing and video games, I think it's something is going to continue. But as we start to get feedback on it, whether or not that's working or not for our audience, like one thing I cannot wait for is a world in video games that includes motion blur. That's me though. Mm-hmm. I think most of our community, most of our players would disagree that that's not an important thing for them. But for me, coming from film and what I'd believe to be viscerally the most immersive thing for me is like seeing motion blur, because that's what we see when we see things move around, you know?
Yeah, because it's part of the, I remember when Peter Jackson came out with Hobbit movies, and they were shot at 48 frames a second. So no motion blur. And you realize that's an important part of motion, is like, it's doing the thinking for you. You don't need all that information to see something move in space.
What's interesting too is that when we shot, I was the DP of an animated film called Escape from Planet Earth, and prior to that, on Christmas Carol, we would specifically have less motion blur and less depth of field in our 3D passes, because our eyes would create that naturally in the 3D world. It's just really interesting how the eyes can trick the mind. And again, high frame rate video games are all the craze. We're always trying to get faster frame rates, we're trying to get sharper graphics, and quicker connection from what your thumbs do, your fingers do, to what your eyes see. But stylistically, you know, I think photoreal is going to have its place. I think Fortnite's fun cartoon look is going to always have its place, and I think that audiences are going to go one way or the other, or they're going to go do both. You know, I think variety is what makes this the most amazing. It opens up opportunities for creative arts. You know, if we were all looking at Monet all day, I think we'd all kind of get sick of Monet.
Yeah, this is actually something. It's actually a good question, that last question, because I think we talked about this a couple conversations ago. Like, kids are growing up in an environment where like really everything's possible, and they're not really able to differentiate between what's being man-made and what's being filmed and what's being recreated. I also talked about how like kids are growing up, an entire generation of kids is growing up with their only interface being glass. And we don't
They
think
pick up
about this,
a magazine
but
and
yeah,
they push them.
for them the novelty is actually going up to a button and pushing it down or twisting something. I think that's why like stop motion animated films are so charming amongst all the other fare out there because they look man-made. They look like they have that kind of grittiness to them or realism that a whole generation of people doesn't have because everything looks just like amazing and high-end
Yeah.
and photorealistic. So people are actually like the counter trend to that is people are trying to look for things that are purposefully made to look man-made or made to look like, you know, like a child made them, for example. So everything
Well,
has its peaks and it has its counter trends and it has its place.
I think we are constantly. I mean, to conversely, imagine what it's like the more that this like deep fake stuff happens, and
Yeah.
we start to see. Visual effects films of f news footage that are fake, and then we're using that to twist media or twist people's views. I mean, there's a side of this could go kind of dark,
I
and
got
that does
another one
not.
for you. There was a guy a couple years ago, I remember he spent 24 hours in a VR world. So he recreated his apartment and then had VR glasses on for 24 hours as an experiment, like a art experiment.
What happened? I gotta know what happened here.
He survived it. He came out okay. It seemed to work fine. Like
Yeah.
there was a bit of a process to get used to it, but if we take that as an example, like, you know, as devices evolve and people are, you know, entering into virtual worlds with ever faster and cheaper devices, there might really be a point, and it sounds like a bad, like a cheesy Hollywood movie, but people take a vacation from virtual reality into reality. You had mentioned, for example, like Mandy will take your phone away from you so that you're not connected.
Yeah, I can't unplug very easily. Like we'll go to Hawaii and she'll have to like my wife will have to like she'll have to shut it all down.
This is interesting. This is like you have to actually pay a premium. People will pay a premium to go to an environment that's not connected or
Yeah.
constantly engaging them or pulling them away.
I
And I
mean
think that's going to
that
be
could be
even more
that
after Corona.
even well you're no you're right because right now we are getting creative on how we're handling all this, and I do believe creatives are pulling us out of it. I mean, the perfect thing is that we just yesterday found out Wonder Woman now here in the States is we're releasing Christmas also on HBO. So it's a new distribution method, and it kind of challenges how the survivability of a movie theater chain can exist if we're finding it our home TV sets are big enough to provide us an immersive experience for a film. Is it better or is it easier for us to sit in our pajamas and hit pause and we gotta go pee to enjoy a film? Or and is that gonna hurt the multiplex industry? So
That's going to be the big test now, right? We
yeah.
get on the other side of this, and if people, when they emerge from their caves, you know, blink from the brightness of the light and walk their way to the movie theater, you know, are people going to want to go to the movies? Are they going to have want to going to have that experience where people are around them laughing? Or are we at the point now where if we sit in a movie theater, we're so jarred by this thing that we're just creeped out that there's people in the same room with us?
I think you and I are going to do fine. I think, especially people that have had enough experience in it, I think it's going to be an interesting thing for our kids, especially elementary kids that are going through this process. And again, I got hope that we're going to be out of this soon. Like, and I have optimism, I should say, that we're going to be out of this soon and safe within maybe a year. I don't think it's going to be something that just gets fixed. I think there's more hurdles we're going to find ourselves in before we're fully out of it. But it comes back to being a mentor, and it comes back to reminding people the value of the arts and communication and socialization in person versus on Facebook or texting. Like I honestly, I miss phone calls. I miss call. I mean, one thing I've loved about this pandemic, you and I have reconnected again, and I've reconnected a lot of people visually. Now you and I have talked over the years, email and occasionally We've met up in person a couple times, but like it's much more rare and difficult for us to do that. But like getting on the phone, I miss, because everyone's just resorting to the texting or the Facebooking and all that stuff. And I mean,
Yeah,
if it were
liking.
easier to disconnect from Facebook, I'd be one of the first ones in line to do it. But
You know, everybody says that. Everybody
yeah.
says, I'm on Facebook and I hate it and I want to leave it, but they just can't leave it. There seems to
Yeah,
be.
what, an old colleague of mine just did a whole thing. He wrote like a whole series about, hey, my wife and I were leaving end of the month Facebook, so everyone say goodbye. We're going to be on this channel. We're going to be this, and here's our email and all this stuff. And he finally got to the point that day and made a little video of him and his wife saying, you know, we just realized we can't, because we have so many people that communicate using Facebook Messenger, or we have family that only knows how to use this program to talk to us, or to face chat, you know, whatever that is. So they made the choice, like, okay, what we're going to do instead is we're going to go Facebook Lite. We're gonna cut out all this stuff. And I think that's what I'm personally probably going to find myself doing, is going Facebook Lite at the new year, and just cutting it down to the bare bones of what it is as a tool, versus a bragging wall, or a self-promoting wall, you know, just something to get up there and be like, hey, I wanted to say hi. I think, versus saying, hey, everyone, look at me. You know, I think that's something I personally want to pull that direction into. So,
I have a
but
good film recommendation. Save Yourselves. I don't know if you've seen it. It's about
haven't seen Save Yourselves,
kind
no.
of a bougie Brooklyn couple decide to take a weekend trip without their and to turn off their devices. And on that exact same weekend, there's an alien invasion. So it's a fun movie. It's very clever, but they have to go. It's the premise of the movie is that they're going to go without their devices for a couple of days for a long weekend, and exactly at that point, there's a global attack by aliens and a pandemic, and they don't have their devices to get the news off of. And so, right when they turn off their devices, that's a gimmick of the movie. It's pretty funny.
Save Yourselves. You know, our friend John, a filmmaker at SCAD, Jonathan Green. Oh man, this is gonna be horrible if he ever sees this, because I'm forgetting his last name. I was gonna look up he Jonathan Green. Yeah, Jonathan Green. I got it right. Jonathan did a documentary on Netflix. I want to say it was called The Social Experiment, but I'm
Social
probably gonna.
Dilemma.
No, Social Dilemma is different. That's
Okay.
the modern one. But his film was about a year ago, maybe a little bit longer. And he it was really great, because it was kind of like him studying these people that like lived to get the attention from social media.
Okay.
And so he went and met some of those social media made celebrities, and talked about how they got into it and why they can't get.
Influencers, so-called.
That's exactly the influencers. And but I was really impressed with the film, and it's sad that I can't remember the title, because we have so many that subject's so popular now. The word social is kind of in everything. Like you just said, Social Dilemma, and I was like, no, it's not it. But yeah, it's that kind of.
Well, to segue, now our social dilemma is that we have to stop talking.
No.
So you and I will carry this on our next conversation.
It's
But
Social Animals. Social Animals is the name of his movie. I had to get that plug in there for Jonathan, because it's a
so
great film. He's a fellow SCAD student, and he did a great job with it. So,
and it's on Netflix.
it's on Netflix.
Well,
Yeah,
hopefully your
Social Animals.
recommendation will give it a little bit more upticks, some views
Yeah, there
this
you go.
weekend.
And he'll throw me a kickback, like maybe send me $2 or something. I don't know. We'll
Sure.
see.
Royalties.
My Venmo, I'm sure. So.
Hey Matt, thank you so much. I had mentioned before that since I talked to the last Pixel, I was like, we got to get Matt over here. The ideal version of it would have been no global pandemic and we would have got you on site. But thanks so much for taking the time, 9 hour time difference, and giving us time like this.
Thanks for having me. Look, I've been watching and reading all up on PIXELvienna. This sounds like such an awesome thing. I really hope that there's a future where we can do this in person, man. Not just to see you and family, but to see all the amazing, talented, and
When this thing's done, I'll be ready to come over, visit you and your pond, on your side of the pond. You come over here. The world is our oyster.
Well, hey man, we'll get through this and we'll be stronger on the other side. That's how I see it. So
Yep.
it's just a matter of time. We can get through it.
I'll be in touch. And if you want, stick around. There's an animation festival coming up next. And
Killer, I'll keep the window running, so that'll be fun.
yeah, keep quiet on the side while you're having your meetings. So
Yeah.
cool.
Thanks, Brian. Thanks, PIXELvienna. Appreciate being a part of this. Thanks a
Thanks so
lot.
much. Love you, man. I'll talk to you soon.
Everybody, take care. Cheers.